And it's the last part of chapter 5, just going into chapter 6. If you're going to follow it, the heading in the church Bibles will be Husbands and Wives. So those of us here, please, who are not husbands or wives, do not switch off. Because it's for all of us, very much so. And these headings, you know, Paul did not put these headings in his letter. They're man-made, and they vary from translation to translation. In fact, my Amplified doesn't have any headings at all, which can make it more difficult to find scriptures. But we need to go back, because the heading isn't even in the right place here. We need to go back to the last sentence of Andy's sermon last week, which is, let's have a look. Where are we? Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your husbands. You see, it follows on. We are to submit to one another. We're to have respect and love for one another. And then he says, wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Saviour. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Now, the word submit, I think, nowadays in the 21st century is almost taboo. But it shouldn't be. It doesn't mean that, you know, you submit to someone, you're absolutely dominated by them and you count down to them and everything is yes sir, no sir, three bags full sir. It does not mean that. It is out of reverence and respect that you submit as we do to the Lord. We love the Lord, we know what he's done for us, and we submit to his lordship. Now, a few years ago, I read a book by a very godly man, a great preacher, and when he finally submitted, took his life to the Lord, became born again, found he had a saviour, he was thrilled and his life changed. But to my horror, I then read that it took 22 years until he said, be my Lord. He then suddenly realized that he was still very much Lord of his life, doing what he wanted to do, planning this, planning that. And when he then said, be my Lord, Lord of everything in my life, his life again changed dramatically. And his relationship with his wife changed dramatically too. Now, we know that in some countries, women are very despised, very trodden down. And apparently Guatemala is one of the worst countries for violence towards women. And a few weeks ago, there was this lovely testimony from a pastor in Guatemala. Because as a child, he was beaten by his father. So when he got married, he beat his wife. He beat his children because that was right, according to him. He just thought that's how he behaved. But when he became a Christian and he realized that maybe he wasn't doing quite the right thing, and Tear Fund so often run marvelous teaching courses where they really get the Word of God into people. And through prayer and workshops from Tear Fund's local church partner, he began to change. And there is a lovely picture of him and his wife, Pastor Armando, and his wife Concepcion, lovely name, smiling and beaming all over their faces because they have a totally different relationship now. And they are consequently helping others in their church and in the communities to love with God's love, to respect and submit to one another. And I think that's just such a lovely example, because it's only through God's love that we can do this anyway. Jesus said, I command you to love one another as I have loved you. He said it twice, command. And we said the other day at house groups, sometimes there are people that are difficult to love. But then we came to the conclusion that we can love them, with God's love poured into our hearts with the power of the Holy Spirit, we might not necessarily like them. Yeah, that's true. I went through a phase of not liking one of my children for quite a long time, but I still loved him. And Paul is obviously very, very concerned about this teaching because he more or less repeats it, word for word really, in his letter to the Colossians. And that, in fact, is headed Holy Living. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. So he says the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. So we submit to the husband as to the Lord. If we are committing our lives, our daily lives to the Lord, then he is guiding us and helping us in every relationship that is. We're submitting to his lordship. And so we are in the centre of his will. This is what he wants. And of course, inevitably, as I've been reading through this chapter over and over, I have thought back to my 51 years of marriage with my husband. And as some of you know, he was a terribly keen cricket player. Incredibly keen. He played all over different countries, different teams. And for some years, he headed up his own team, and he was captain of it. But it didn't mean to say that he ruled the team. You know, they met together once a week to look at fixtures and to talk, and they pooled their ideas. But I suppose in the end, he was the one who made final decisions. And I thought, yeah, because that was a team. I thought, we were a team together. We were a pretty good team together. But he was the captain. Yeah, maybe we sometimes didn't quite agree about how this should be done, that should be done, but I think more often than not, he was right, and then there'd be a sort of compromise. You know, it's this mutual respect, isn't it? Not just, as I said, wives and husbands, but with the body of Christ, because actually, this is really what this is about. Because Paul goes on to say, if you love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. Wow, that is quite something, isn't it? And this is really, I think, the main thrust of this little passage here. That we are, as well, being cleansed and made ready to be the bride of Christ. Spotless, holy, blameless. We might have a little way to go. You remember when Esther was chosen to be the king's wife? She went through a whole year of beauty preparations. Can't imagine, can you, a whole year? But that was so necessary. She had to be so beautiful for her husband. And Jesus is taking a very long time, isn't he, to prepare us and to make us beautiful. But it's so important because his bride is what he wants to be. The most wonderful example of his tremendous love and light, and I know it's too difficult to explain, isn't it, really? Jesus, of course, never married when he was on earth. We know that, don't we? I know there are some people who say, oh, yes, he did, and he fathered children, and that's why all through the generations there have been special people. Well, that's not. It's not right. He's waiting to be married. He will be married because we are going to be his bride. We are being sanctified. Amazing. We know this because We are told about the marriage feast of the Lamb. That's going to be some feast. How many people there? Billions and billions. How long could it take to serve? Wonderful idea. But this is the wonderful, wonderful marriage feast of the Lamb. We are going to be the bride. Marvellous. So, Paul goes on to say this is a profound mystery. He talks about, he goes right back to Genesis. He says, we're all members of one body, of his body, male, female, his body, the bride. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. And he says, this is a profound mystery. But I'm talking about Christ and the church. That's the mystery, isn't it? This amazing relationship between Christ and his church. And then he says, however, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. And then, going into chapter 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honour your father and mother, that's a commandment, the old commandment, which is the first commandment with a promise, because if you do that, then it may go well with you, and you may enjoy long life on the earth. And word to fathers, do not exasperate your children, instead bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. That's quite a job, isn't it? Yes, well, I think I'm going to leave it there, because I think it's very clear, this message here, of living in harmony with one another, in bearing with one another. I did actually put a thing in Colossians. I do think this is important. Let me finish with the word of God. Therefore, as God's chosen people, this is Colossians chapter 3, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. And as you sing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That's really very good teaching, isn't it? Yes, not easy, but with God's help, we can do this. It's God's great desire that we should be his holy bride, his sanctified bride. And what an honour. It's just too amazing to think about, really, isn't it? Yes. So let's stand and sing our last song. We can't remember the church. Oh, church arise. And it does talk about the bride.
I'm just saying, as you're saying, you know, Esther, we have nearly 4 months to prepare for the king, not for the tribunal.